1962, the Supreme Court has ruled that school prayer and Bible reading will cease in all public school systems. It is now official, God has been removed from the classroom in the United States of America.
Come on. Are you ready? Come on. I'm in the change, are you ready? Well, the power of Jesus is in me. God's turn now.
It's hard. The gates of hell come crashing down. And you begin to see the
church of God. Woo! The church of God is alive. Are you ready?
Alive and strong.
The world
has come. It's time to lift the name of Jesus high.
Arise and shine,
for the light has come. It's time to lift the name of Jesus high. Arise and shine,
for the light
has come. It's time to lift the name of Jesus high.
Rise and shine, for the light is
come. It's time to lift the name of Jesus high.
Woo! Yes! God's turn!
It's our
turn
now!
Amen! God's turn!
From the chain!
From the chain! We're ready for the chain! God's turn on to you! The power of Jesus!
It's our turn now! Sing it now!
Rise and shine!
Woo!
Praise the Lord!
The church
is alive! Amen! The church of the blessed alive! Get ready! Woo! Heavenly King's coming! Have a great God! Get ready to have this plan!
Now! It's no surprise!
Woo!
The gates of hell crash down! When you begin to see the church arrive!
Amen! Hallelujah. One more. You are loved. Maybe there's those that are feeling they're unloved. You are loved this morning. I want you to know that. God loves you. God loves you. Praise you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness, your mercy,
friend. In the weirdest places, broken souls with smiling faces, fighting for surrender. For now and the after, yeah. Just look around and you see the people. I'm scared to say how they really feel. Oh, we all need a little honesty. Yeah.
You are loved.
If your heart's in a thousand pieces, if you're lost and far from reason, just look up, know you are loved. Just look up, know
you are
loved. All sides, heroes, a light not expecting, but not quite perfected yet. Look up, see the sun is shining. There's hope on a new horizon. Calling you, it's calling
you.
I love if your heart's in a thousand pieces. If you're lost and you're far from reason,
just alive, you know you're
loved. You are love, and it feels like something's missing. If it hurts, but you can't find healing, just look up, know you are love. Just look up, know you are love. You don't have to prove yourself. Don't try to be someone else. You don't have to prove yourself.
You are
love.
Just
a couple. You are love.
Amen. Amen. This is Dawn O'Brien, prophetess, servant of the Lord. Thank you for tuning in this morning. You know, the reason why you're seeing that picture up there, I asked the Holy Spirit, I said, God, what do you want me to put up this morning? You know, because I placed scriptures and I put whatever the Holy Spirit wants me to put up there because, you know, I'm not going to be live where you're seeing me face to face today because of the time and things that the time is going faster and faster. It's easy for me just to stick a picture up there. And this is what he said for me to do, and I'm going to share with you what God was saying to me, and Jesus is going to get all the praise and glory because, you know, miracles are about to start in your life and in my life. Praise God. You know, this morning we're going to talk. I told you I was going to wait till Monday, but I'm going to do it now. He gave me two words on 5/1/20 just a few days ago, and I'm calling it Pentecost. It's almost here. Power of the Holy Spirit, like the book of Acts. But he gave me two words we're going to talk about today. Children, you will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way. And then another one he gave to me, where is it? Hold on. I don't have it right now. Here, let's see here. I was asking the Holy Spirit when we're getting out of this cave, all right? You know, and God never tells me when exactly, okay? But he always tells me when if he's getting ready to do something. Well, I heard him say to me out of nowhere, he said, you will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way. And then I've got, like I said, I've got two words I'm going to share with you. In a minute, we're going to talk about that. But I want to read this word, you know, and I know God's getting ready to move. Because Prophet Russ had a word this morning I'm going to share with you. And remember, I talked about your spiritual baby is coming forth, and it is, not just for me, but for others as well. I'm going to read you. Let's pray before we get started. Let's pray. Did you put your full armor on? Saints, it's important. I told you, before you leave that house, put the full armor of God on you. We're living in a modern day Sodom and Gomorrah. So let's pray. Father, we just come together in agreement right now, Lord Jesus. Father, we, the body of believers, come together, Lord, and we pray. We cover this video with the blood of Jesus, Lord. Holy Spirit, I ask you to speak through me. Anoint me, Lord, to speak your very words, Lord. These are not my words, they're your words, Lord. And we give you the praise and glory, Lord. So, Father, I ask that everyone that you would want to hear would tune in, Lord, and that you would just touch your people, that miracles are going to begin to come forth. I really, truly believe that, Lord. You've been showing me that it's coming, that now is the time, Lord. And we just give you all the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' mighty name. And we put that full armor, if you didn't put on, put the helmet of salvation, loins girded with truth, the breastplate of righteousness. We shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, and we take the shield of faith to quench every fire dart the wicked one brings against us, and the sword of spirit, which is the word of God. You can read that in Ephesians 6:10-20, the whole armor of God. Place that I told you, put it on mirrors, put it wherever you see. I have it on the front door as well. I make sure I put on 3 or 4 times a day or more. But put on before you even leave the house. And then I told you before, read Psalm 91, safety abiding in the presence of God. All right. Maybe we should read that. I love this. I love the Psalms. I love the Psalms. I love the Proverbs. You know, David, he wrote the Psalms, most of them, you know, and you know, I love to write poetry. I've written, gosh, almost 500 poems or more, actually, you know, and even my dad says your poems are getting better, and they are, and I give God the glory. You know, it's not me speaking. When I read you poems, these are actual things that I've gone through or I'm still going through, so you're getting firsthand. This is not a made-up story when I read you things. You know, you're getting the truth of what I'm a testimony, and I give Jesus the glory. And see, that's what you and I have to be, testimonies. People want to see something that's real. They don't want to see something phony. They don't want to hear about a made-up story. I'm going to tell you right now, because people are hurting. They're already hurting, and they're going to be hurting even more. And you and I are to be bright beacons in a world that is dying and passing away. And it's going away very quickly. We're seeing the world change, and we've got to come out, and we've got to be separate. God is calling us forth in these last days. There are many ways the harvest is plenty, but the workers are few. He needs more of us to get in line with what he's doing. You know, I'm just going to stop here right now and just say this, you know. And, You know, I want you to know, I don't say this where I'm not mercy motivated, because I am. I cry. I'm very sensitive, like a John, like, what am I, Weeping Jeremiah. I'm very sensitive to the Lord. Okay. But I guess I see these people with their videos. And remember I told you riots are going to start. It's starting on a government level, and then it's going to go to the higher level. They're going to come at the nation, okay? And in a minute, we're going to talk about some of these. President Donald Trump signed these, I can't think. See, I told you, I don't know much about news. Those two, executive orders. He signed some executive orders, and, his freedom's being, I'm just going to tell you right now, the president only has so much. We've got to stop serving President Donald Trump. We've got to serve Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We're to pray for President Donald Trump, that he would make the right decisions in America yet, because I'm going to tell you right now, things are going to happen very quickly, soon here, and when they start happening, it's going to happen, all right? And we've got to get grounded in the Lord, built on a solid right Christ Jesus, not in sinking sand, or we're going to fall away. I told you before, there's going to be a great falling away, you know, and a lot of people are not paying attention. A lot of people are not listening. The Christians are not listening even now. All right. We've already seen this first wave of this COVID-19. We're going to see a second wave. All right. Now I'm going to talk to you for just a minute, and we're going to read this Psalm 91. But I saw this video, I think it was in Texas, where this lady was out there talking to reporters and, you know, say, well, we want to open up the business. Now, I'm not saying I'm against what she believes. I'm for freedom. I'm for what's right. I'm going to tell you right now, though, we in America have had our freedoms, and you want to know something? We didn't do anything with it, all right? The Christians didn't stand up. The Christians didn't speak out. Now we're getting upset because we're getting tied down, locked up in our cave. Well, I told you before, I've been in three different caves, so I know personally what it feels like to not get out of your cave. So I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be insensitive, but I don't want to hear any moaning and complaining, because you want to know something? There are Americans, yes, they're all worried about their jobs and all that, but what about before? Yeah, you still want your evil agendas. You want to kill and murder millions of babies. You want the same-sex marriage. You want to do everything that's ungodly. Worship your idols. Worship your false gods. But yet you sit there and you're moaning and complaining. Well, you're getting what you asked for, because you did not choose to stand up and speak truth. All right? My hand's shaking. I'm sorry. All right? We're not talking about starting riots. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about getting your prayer closet and pray for your governors. Pray for your mayors. Start speaking truth. Pastors, quit. You're in your homes right now. Start preaching the truth to your congregation. There are those still preaching false doctrine. All right? Normalism is over. I'm going to tell you right now. It is God's hour. Do you hear me? I've said this before. You had your hour. The devil had his time. It's God's turn now. All right? One last mighty move of God. So we need to pray. We need to come together. All right? We're living in a modern day Sodom and Gomorrah. I'm going to tell you it's going to get worse. It's not going to get any better. I'm not going to hear a punch in the back and tell you, oh, it's going to get better. You can go back to your clubs. You go to your gyms. You go to this and do that and go back and just forget about God. No, 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 no. God is going to, that's it. I told you before, if we do not listen to what God is saying, he's just going to do it. I told you this several times. I know people don't want to hear it. Well, oh, well, you don't want to hear it. Now you have to hear it. You notice how you have to hear it? You're stuck in your cage and you have to hear it. I'm waiting to go out into the lion's den. That's right. It's God's turn now. God is going to send his chosen servants out there to do the work that he's called them to do. And there's going to be others. Remember, I told you the book I'm writing. Men and women coming out of their caves. Don't die in your cave. Don't die in your cave. All right? God's going to have his way. Yes, the wheat and tares are going to grow together. We're going to deal with persecution. We're going to deal with people that don't want to hear. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. You and I got to get backbone. I'm going to tell you right now. I'm still getting it because they're going to grit their teeth. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear what you or me have to say. But you know what? We're to pray for them and love them. God will make us peace with our enemies. As we love them and pray for them, God will touch them. We need to pray for more people to come to Christ. I believe this is the hour. This is the hour for our families to be saved. This is the hour for the world to be saved. We're going to see them in millions. Millions. I'm going to tell you right. Then there are others that will not believe. It don't matter. You may plant that seed and they'll refuse to believe it. But you know what? All you can do is pray for them and do plant the seed. That's all you can do. And leave them in the Lord's hands. Pray for them. Don't let them upset you. I'm going to tell you right now. There are going to be people that are going to upset you and me. So, but what do we got to do? We got to smile and love them. We got to watch our words. Let our words be few. Set guard watches over our mouth. Lord, help me. You know, I'm a talker. Set guard watch over our mouth. Quick to listen, so to speak. So to become angry. You know, because the enemy wants to get you and I angry. It's getting loud out there. That's why I love to be in my cave alone with the Lord. When you go out to the world, it's loud. It's getting loud. It's going to get a lot louder. This is just the beginning. We ain't seen nothing yet. All right? So we're going to have to look to the Lord. I'm going to tell you right now. We can't be looking to anyone else to help us. We've got to get our eyes on Jesus. I don't know how many times I got to say that. We've got to get our eyes on Jesus because only Jesus can help you. Your mayor, your governor, I'm going to tell you, they're not going to be able to help you. Your president, he can only do so much, and they're taking power away from him. We've got the New World Order out there. Yes, we do. We got the Democrats pushing their evil agenda, which they did back in 2019. They said they couldn't impeach President Trump. They were going to make the economy collapse. Oh, we're going to talk about something again. I'm going to keep reminding you about those two videos. I'm going to tell you right now that the Holy Spirit gave me wisdom. He's the one that brought me to those videos. They know exactly what they're doing. I'm going to tell you right now. Lord, help me watch what I say, but I'm going to tell you right now. They know what they're doing. They know what they're doing. God's not going to put up with it. God sees. God's going to have his way. Man thinks they're going to have their way. I'm going to tell you right now. Ain't happening. God's going to have his way. He'll protect you and I, saints, if we're walking with God. But if we're not, we're in trouble. We've got to stay close to the Lord. All right. I go in another direction. All right. Put that safety of abiding in the presence of God. See, it's all about God. It's not about me. I got notes here, and I've done this before. I got a ton of notes here. And you know what? Wherever God wants me to go is where I'm going, I guess. You know, because it's about him. It's not about me. Did I read your prophet Russ's word? I don't even know. All right, let's read it. I don't think I did. Because I love his word today. This is a good word. Let me read to you. The Father says today, this is promotion time for you. Amen. Are you ready? I'm ready. I'm encouraging you. I hope you're getting encouraged. It's promotion time. There are those I know been waiting. I've been waiting. I told you over 25 years, it's coming. It's coming. Remember, God does precept upon precept. He's in no hurry. He takes his time. Oh, man, that is one thing I'm learning. He's taking his time. No, we're not going home yet. I'm not talking about going home. All right? I'm not saying it's over. It's over for the America that we were used to. But there's going to be a new America. That's right. A new America. And so God's not done yet with America. I've talked about that before. I've told you there's going to be prayer up in the White House. Damn, people think I'm crazy. But I know what God showed me. He showed me that more than like three times. There are going to be no briefings. There's going to be prayer. Do you hear what I'm saying? Your sleeping days are over. Remember I told you that? Well, lately I've been getting some sleep. Thank you, Jesus. But I know what that's like when you're up and down, up and down. I mean, I still get, I think I got three or four times last night, but I did sleep. Praise God. Okay, let's read Prophet Russ's word. The Father says today, this is promotion time for you. Amen. You're about to break the tape and win the trophy of a race well run. The heart of an eagle saint beats in your chest, and your time in the henyard of religious poultry mongers is over. You have been one who has walked a long journey with me, and I've seen that says God. And I've seen your faithfulness when others have turned away. And it made me cry this morning. God sees. Don't think that God doesn't see what's going on behind closed doors. He sees what you've gone through. He sees what I've gone through. What you and I have gone through. God sees. It doesn't matter whether man gives you credit. God sees. All right? And he goes on to say here, You are not a beginner in the knowledge of my kingdom. You have a hearing ear to receive my word and apply it in faithfulness when you sense the winds of my spirit blowing. This is a time for running the race that is before you on the backstretch of favor bestowed and strength outpoured by my hand into your spiritual sinews. You will run the way of my commandments with fresh vigor and renewed endowment to be the champion that I've called you to be. Amen. As you run, there'll be many on the right and on the left that will want to hand you something to drink of their thinking or give you advice on running the race. But the Father says, I am your refreshing. Do not allow others or their opinions about your choices to distract you from what I'm purposing to do. There is a great tearing down taking place in your life so that I can do a great building up. Amen. I am doing a new thing, says the Father. So get ready. Put on your running shoes. Immerse yourself in my truth and not the opinions of men. For the opinions of men will not sustain you where I'm taking you, says the Father. It is a serious time. It's a serious time, but also a time of blessing. Blessings you have waited on for a long time are on their way to you this day. As you humble yourself and find a place of renewed cooperation with me and my word in your life, says the Father. Amen. And remember that word I've given several words actually about our spiritual baby. Okay. Your spiritual baby is coming forth, says the Lord. I gave that word, that one of them I gave on 10/13/19. That was last year. No more time for wait and delay. That time is now, says the Lord. The last shall be first. You're moving up, my sons and daughters, to the front lines. Get ready, my chosen servants, to perform and do greater miracles for my name, Yeshua. Make sure to give me, King Jesus, all the glory, honor, and praise. Remember, it's not you performing the miracles. It is my son, Yeshua, Yahweh, the great I am. This will happen suddenly. And I've said this before. What God is getting ready to do is going to be sudden. My Holy Spirit will come upon you in my power, says the Lord. You will change and be transformed. Amen. The Holy Spirit has equipped you with everything you need for this hour. That is why he has been preparing you for such a time as this. You are my chosen servants, my remnant. I will anoint and use for this final hour. Stand your ground and get ready. The vision is here and now for you to go forth. Wait until I say go. And when I say go, run with the vision. Amen. And I love this scripture. If you don't have it, write it down. The Holy Spirit gave me this years ago. And I read it all the time. Habakkuk 2:2-3. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain on tablets. That even one who reads it. For the vision is yet for a point of time, but at the end it will speak and will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. And it may not be your time yet, saints. That means you just wait and you keep waiting. You know, Daniel said to me, remember, it's like in a doctor's office. You're waiting for your name to be called. And when it's time, then you go. So when God calls your name, you run with that vision. Okay, on that same day at 7 a.m., I was walking out of the bathroom talking to the Lord. I asked him if he could wait. And the Holy Spirit said to me, there is no more time to wait. I had a small vision where I saw not just me, but others that have been in caves for a long time coming out. And that's why I've told you there are more of you coming out. It's a new season for you and me. All right. Praise God. It's coming forth. And, you know, you can check out all these videos. You know, I've done so many, and I give God the praise. And I'm not saying everything I say is Holy Spirit. Pray for me. I want to hear the voice of the Lord clearly. And so I'm praying. You can go on the YouTube and listen to His word. I do have another website that is just my prophetic words. You're welcome to go on there. They're still there right now. That's my backup channel as well. And, you know, I don't know where I'm going to be soon. I'm waiting on the Lord to open the doors for me. And I give Jesus the praise and glory. Did you see this this morning? North Korea, South Korea troops exchange gunfire along border. I don't check up much news. I just tell you enough so you know what's going on. You know, they thought he was dead because he hadn't shown his face, and then I guess he did. So he's alive. So North and South Korean troops exchanged fire along their tense border on Sunday. They're saying, can you believe this? The South military said the first such incident since the rivals took unprecedented steps to lower frontline animosities. And God said you're going to have wars and rumors of wars. Violent confrontations have occasionally occurred along the border, the world's most heavily fortified. While Sunday's incident is a reminder of persistent tensions and didn't cause any known casualties on either side. All right, so that's what we're seeing. Now, I want to read this word by a gentleman named Alan from 444 News. He says here that the Holy Spirit gave him this word. He said, hello, my son, this is Jehovah Elohim. Speaking with you this day, my precious children, you sense with your heart and perceive in your mind the lateness of the hour. You see that things on the earth have changed and not necessarily for the good. You see your liberty stripped and see, I told you, it's happening. Okay, but what are you going to do about it? Are you going to preach truth? We're not talking about rioting. I'm talking about standing up in your cave and preaching truth. All right, doing what we know is right. Okay, not starting fighting and ending up somewhere where we can end up killed. Okay, I'm not saying we're not to speak out. Yes, when it's time for us to get out of our cave, lion's den, yes, we need to speak whatever the Holy Spirit tells us. He will protect us and keep us safe. But if we go ahead on our own and get going and do all these things that God didn't tell us to do, we're going to have problems. I'm going to tell you right now, we're going to have the power of the Holy Ghost in these last days. You see strife within your relationships. You see your jobs destroyed or hanging on by a thread. All these are the results of the birth pains that I've written about in my holy word. Those whose spirit has been regenerated are born again, know things are not right in the earth, and this is good for you, are now turning to me in greater numbers. Well, there's going to be more. I really truly believe that. My calling to each of you is now rise from where you're at and preach my word to the lost, the hurting, destitute, the confused, and show them my truth, my love, and my ways for you to go. The fields are now ripe for the harvest, and now I now point you as harvesters. According to your faith, you will bring in a bountiful harvest indeed, and great will be your reward. Because of the times in which you live, there is no need to plan for a future in a normal world. See, it's not going to go back to being normal. I'm going to tell you right now, it'll never be normal again. Okay, and I'm not trying to be a doom and gloom preacher. I'm telling you the truth. All right, change is here, and it's gonna keep going, all right? But we've got to get closer to the Lord. All right? For the world has passed away and my judgments come. Be encouraged, my children, and be an encouragement in so many that have become disillusioned because of what has come upon the earth. I now raise each of you into your positions that I have ordained since the beginning of time itself, and you will do and see mighty things. Follow me, and together we will see mountains. I am. Okay, you can read a scripture. He has a scripture, Isaiah 66, if you'd like to read that. All right, I got this off Elijah list. I like her. JoJo Dawson said, a seasonal shift coming to many regions. She said she had a prophetic dream where she was a very snow place. The landscape was really cold and many things were frozen. Then I saw the several polar bears walk past me. They were walking in a line looking sad and defeated. Some were walking by themselves, and others were walking next to each other in groups of two or three. There were also white tigers walking past me. Just like the polar bears, they were walking in a line. Some were walking by themselves, and others were walking beside each other. However, neither the polar bears nor the tigers ever looked at me. As soon as I woke up from the dream, the Lord began to speak to me about the interpretation. She said here, polar bears and white tigers often represent religious spirits and dreams. Frozen landscapes with ice and snow can represent hindrances or opposition. I believe that this prophetic dream was prophetic insight from the Lord about regional religious strongholds being removed. Religious spirits that have been opposing the true people of God are about to retreat. The polar bears and white tigers in this dream appear to be defeated and were retreating. The time is up for religious spirits in certain regions, she said. The corrupt agenda seeking opposing spirits will soon begin to flee from regions where God is moving. We're about to see a powerful outpouring of the Spirit come and blow fresh wind on the body of Christ, which I believe that. That's in one of the words I'm going to share with you. I believe that as this seasonal shifts, we will see those who are hungry for a move of God experience revival and awakening that will sweep across regions. Those who have opposed and criticized kingdom ministries and the individuals will be silent, and the kingdom will advance in those regions. Many will move in the apostolic and the prophetic, and life will return to the people of God. I believe many salvations, miracles, signs, and wonders will break through in this next season. Religious structures and regions are going to be shaken, and many who have natural dominion will dwindle and fade. As the shift takes place, revival will come to many ministries, churches, and regions. God is removing man-made programs, and I believe that. God is removing man-made programs and placing them with His Holy Spirit and fire. I believe it's going to be like they used to be. Remember those tent meetings? I mean, we're not going to be drinking our coffees, eating, and dancing around like we're in a nightclub. I mean, there's no respect and honor to Jesus. We've lost all that. We're about to experience a powerful move of God, and everything will change. We'll see the kingdom coming. God's will be done in our regions as it is in heaven. Things will move and change, and what is not from God will be uprooted. And I just said that the other day. This is a confirmation. The prophetic words that have been spoken over regions, cities, and individuals will begin to come to pass. The religious spirits and agendas that you have been fighting for years are being removed, and new life and growth will come to your region. God is on the move, so get in position to partner with heaven to see regional strongholds removed. Amen. All right. Praise God. All right. I'm just going to retouch some of this because we've talked about it before, but I want to recapture to keep you up to date with what's going on. Then I'm going to give you those words because we're almost there. Change is coming. Praise God. All right. Now, I've got a video coming out. I saw this, a recurring dream of another plague that's coming. And I've talked about there's going to be other plagues. And other people have talked about it. Go listen to this Watchman for Christ share a recurring dream this brother had on another virus coming. People were stealing medications, he said, and they were covered with rashes and sores. They looked like boils. And if you remember, I told you it's going to get so bad. When Daniel and I were going through that America's Christ, that situation, remember? And God finally spoke to me, and I said, God, where are you? And He said, I'm teaching you how to handle crisis situation, because America's going to go through one. And here we are. And when we were going through that, God was showing me, because I would try to get his anxiety medicine filled, and there was no medication. So, I would tell him, just use it when you need it. Even now, you know, he doesn't need anymore, thank God. But, you know, he still gets anxious, though. I'm dealing with that here at the house. So pray for me, saints, because I just believe all of us, we've got to be seeking God in these last days. It's so important. All right. So we're still dealing with that. And the enemy's coming at me in ways, more than ways than one. But praise the Lord. All right. But go look at this. I believe, is this virus he's talking about? Is this the second wave to come? Now, they're saying it. We can see it in later months of this year. I mean, the virus is not done. We pray that it quit spreading. You know, France calls, did you hear about this? France calls for health passports as Germany rolls out immunity cards. The mayor of Nice has urged French PM Philip to introduce new travel controls during the COVID-19 pandemic through health passports in parts of France which border other countries. See, they're not going to let you travel unless you've been vaccinated, I believe. All right. Remember, Bill Gates, he talked about it. He said things won't get back to normal until we have gotten a vaccine out to the entire world. All right. Now, we've talked about this, okay, and I'm just going to talk about it again. Now, I want to know, I told you, all right, go look, let me pull it up here. President Trump, we're going to talk about Bill Gates and that. President Trump, he signed two executive orders, okay. A video I put up yesterday by Underground World News, it lets me share those videos. Trump having determined that it is necessary to augment the regular armed forces of the United States for a named operational mission, specifically the Enhanced Department of Defense Counter-Narcotic Operation in the Western Hemisphere. Trump signs another executive order securing the United States bulk power system. Go look at that. And then somebody sent this to me. All right. And I put this video down for you to go look at it. Now, people tell me, oh, that was how many years ago? Well, I'm going to tell you right now. I don't have time to go through everything. So you need to pray about it for yourself. All right. Whether or not it was years ago, I'm going to tell you right now, we're seeing the New World Order play out right here, all right? And on the beginning, it says, FEMA has more power than the President of the United States or the Congress. It's a power to suspend laws, move entire populations, arrest, and detain citizens without a warrant, and hold them without trial. It can seize property, food supplies, transportation systems, and can suspend the Constitution. So go look at that video. That's why I said President Donald Trump can only do so much. We need to pray for him, okay? Because I'm telling you, there are others that are in control that are up in the White House, all right? And you and I, all we can do is pray. Now, remember that COVID-19 pandemic causing global fire crisis, financial crisis, all right? I showed you those two exercises. I'm telling you, saints, if you haven't seen them, go see it. I mean, it's so eerie. I'm looking at it. It's like federal agencies and numerous media outlets have confirmed that Chinese and CDC tests are contaminated, which, you know, Alex Jones talked about it, and the CDC said they were contaminated. So why would we want to test like Bill Gates says? But on those videos, if you go take a look at it, I couldn't believe it. The one talks about 2019 global short pandemic exercise, and it was hosted by the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security in partnership with the World Economics Forum and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation of October 18, 2019. Now, tell me, how does he know all this? You know, he's not no prophet. I'm going to tell you right now, Bill Gates is not a prophet. He's got a lot of money. So he doesn't know all this. I'm going to tell you right now, there are people working behind closed doors that you and I know nothing about. He's not a prophet, all right? Remember, I looked at that the biologics, where they got the CDC kits. They were from part of Singapore, which is part of China and Japan. On that video, remember that video? It looks exactly, go look at it. I'm serious, saints. It looks exactly what we're seeing right now, what we saw really bad with the models, remember? And then Giuliani said Fauci gave $3.7 million to Wuhan Laboratory in 2014. Now, why is President Donald Trump, you know, he's been listening to Dr. Fauci and Dr. Birx. They were with President Obama, okay? So this was all planned. I'm going to tell you right now. Then I told you, I look at that video. Go listen to it. It talks about the worst economic depression in history. U.S. healthcare and health insurance systems have collapsed. Medical supplies, I'm trying to read my writing. Half of the healthcare force has died. Death rates are soaring. Nationalized health system. That's, what is that, like the Obamacare? You know, they're going to rationalize food one day, too, as well. Government is paying controls and nations and rations all of Medicare, it says. And then it talks about the president, all right? It talks about the president remains in critical condition. The vice president out of intensive care, he remains unstable to do his constitutional agenda. Therefore, the Speaker of the House. Which is what? Who is that? Nancy Pelosi. She's the one that's the acting Britain. That's what they want. That's what they want. All right? They want to push their evil agenda on us. And that's why I said, saints, you and I need to stand up for what's right. Not cause chaos and not cause rioting, But we need to pray. We need to get in our prayer closet and pray, because this is just the beginning of what we're seeing. All right. Now, there have been large earthquakes by Japan and Puerto Rico, if you've seen. Hawaii still swarming. Idaho swarming. Utah. There's been earthquakes in Washington, Oregon. California still swarming. Now, there was a Los Angeles, I think it was this morning, 3.3 earthquake rattled Los Angeles. The quake was centered about a mile northwest of Chatsworth, a neighborhood in the San Fernando Valley. Okay, now remember, I'm just going over everything to tell you. I can't go through it all. That remember that dream I had on 3/24/20 about the San Andreas fault line has been about the San Andreas earthquake. I'm sorry, 3/2/20, and I had a 3/18/20 that massive earthquake that's coming to the United States, and I also had I got a few words. 5/23/19, massive earthquake coming to the United States of America. Got that again. And then remember about 3 years ago, he said move away from the West Coast. And we're seeing that. Nevada, Canada, Mexico, Washington, Oregon. I mean, we're seeing that. All right. And we've talked about those. Five dangerous fault lines. I'm not going to go through all that right now. The scariest fault line. And we've talked about those three things that I think that I believe the Holy Spirit was showing me. Hawaii, Yellowstone. He's told others as well. I'm right in that area. Yellowstone, Utah, Colorado, all in that area. The West Coast. And also, I've given it, so as others, about down the middle of the United States. We've seen them in Oklahoma, Missouri, southern part of Illinois. We've seen, Tennessee, parts of Tennessee. I mean, this is right before. We've even seen them up in Pennsylvania, New York, all right, Alaska. So I'm not going to share all that right now. We've talked about that before. And this, now I'm going to share this with you. I've given you that link to spaceweather.com so that you can go on there as well. We talked about this. Now, I just saw this yesterday. And you can go and you can pull up the different days it lets you. It said there on March 11, 2011, a magnitude 9.0 earthquake occurred near the east coast of Honshu, Japan. But it's talking about reflected tsunamis in space weather. When the earth trembles, even the edge of space moves, they're saying. Researchers have known for decades that earthquakes and tsunamis send waves of air pressure to the very top of Earth's atmosphere. They're up there in the ionosphere. The waves scramble GPS signals and interfere with radio communications, much like solar flares do. Earthquakes, it turns out, can mimic space weather. Now, I told you that I talked to scientist John L. Casey. He lives here in Florida almost 3 years ago, and he said that we could see earthquakes so large that people will be without water and power for weeks and months at a time, and how we need to fix infrastructures. Well, I think President Donald Trump said he was going to do that, but it's a little late for that. I mean, We're about to see this stuff start happening, all right? Now, I saw this today on Space Weather. It talked about here that Halley's Comet versus the supermoon. Earth is approaching a stream of debris from Halley's Comet. And I told you, remember, NASA doesn't tell us. We have close-to-Earth objects of asteroids, meteors, fireballs, comets. They don't tell you and I nothing. All they say is, we need to leave the planet. Seriously, NASA, where are we going to go? I mean, the Bible talks about in the last days in Revelation, people are going to hide under rocks or in caves. So there's nowhere we can go. All we can do is pray. All right. It's going to happen. I'm going to tell you right now. We could also, you know, we're not going to hit directly, I don't feel, right now. God's not done. We could have debris, though, that can cause major earthquakes and volcanoes and the whole ring of fire to just blow. And things could start happening. I mean, I'm not an expert, so don't ask me. I'm not an expert. I'm learning just like you are about this earthquake stuff. I find it interesting. I mean, I wish I knew more, but that's not my field. But I just know enough to tell you. They're saying that Earth is approaching a stream of debris from Halley's Comet, and that if forecasters are correct, the shower will peak on May 5th and 6th, and that's in a few days, producing one of the best meteor showers of the year, so they're saying. I don't know if that would be a pretty thing to see, because I believe something could happen. They're saying that, where is it? That the 2020 Aquarian meteor shower has a problem. The supermoon intense glare from one of the biggest full moons of the year will reduce the number of visible meteors. So they won't be visible. They'll be 40 per hour. From the usual 40 per hour to no more than 10 to 15 per hour. Now, I'm wondering, could there be some that are not visible that could happen suddenly? Remember, I told you God's about to do something suddenly. So it says on here that reduce the number of visible meteors. That doesn't mean that they're not going to have any. It could be invisible where you and I don't see it. So could God allow something to happen that these people that are forecasting this can't see it coming? I believe that. I'm telling you right now, I believe God's going to allow something that man's not going to be able to do anything to stop it. All right, we've talked about this too. Hold on one second here. Why NASA, remember we talked about it. NASA plans to slam a spacecraft into an asteroid. Now, seriously, that can cause more problems. We try to figure out how God does everything, and we're trying to stop something from happening. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, man's not going to be able to stop what God's going to do. God's going to have his way. Man thinks he's going to stop it. He's not going to be able to do nothing. So we can either get in line with what God's doing, or we're going to have problems here. They said enormous asteroid big enough to leave a 6-mile-wide crater and darken the world with dust, if it hit Earth, will harmlessly zip by, which did on April 29th, okay? But they're going to do this, let me see, what day? They're supposed to start this, let's see, where is it? Hold on one second. It says NASA's launching a spacecraft next year to conduct the first test of a one promising strategy for stopping a killer asteroid. The double asteroid redirection test, or calling it DART, will slam a spacecraft into the smaller of two asteroids orbiting each other. Any change in the smaller object's orbit will be easy to measure from Earth and will provide a good indicator of whether it's been successfully traveling at nearly 20,000 miles an hour. I don't think that's a good thing. I don't think they should mess with that, because it could actually cause a problem. We need to pray. But you know what? God knows. God knows all this. All right, saints. I don't read all of this. I talked about it on the last video. Did you see that video also where Pentagon just released? All right? They're already trying to brainwash you and not twist it around, all right? They're going to call what's evil good and what's good evil, okay? Daniel saw this on TV. You know, he watches that History Channel, also that Ancient Aliens. I don't watch it. But he said that they had that on there. And they also had that time, that thing with President Trump on there. They were showing this thing that they showed on the news that Pentagon just released, that unidentified objects taken by U.S. Navy pilots. All right? But And they're laughing. They think this is funny, you know. They're calling it UFOs. But I'm going to tell you right now, you and I know it's not UFOs. It's demons. The world thinks they're seeing UFOs. They are laughing. They're demons. We're getting ready to see a shaking. And I believe that. When we Christians go home, I said to be with Jesus, they're going to say we're bad and UFOs took us out of here. Remember, just the other day, I heard the Holy Spirit say this to me out of nowhere. The hour is late, for I'm coming like a whirlwind. And then on 4:25:20, he said it again. I long coming like a whirlwind. I will scatter nations with the breath of my tongue. Isaiah 5:20, woe, judgment is coming to those who call evil good and good evil, who substitute darkness for light and light for darkness, who substitute bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. All right. So this is what we're seeing. All right. And remember we talked about we could see an EMP in the near future. Now, I don't know when, but seriously, with the sun, remember we've talked about this. If we're not even prepared for the coronavirus, imagine the consequence if we get hit with a real existent threat. Like an EMP. What if our power goes out? You know, Daniel gets mad at me. He's like, why are you buying all the ink? Why are you printing everything? I said, because I believe we're going to have an EMP. I don't know when, but it's coming. We're going to lose power. All right? Then what are we going to do? You know, I told you a long time ago. This was when I first started. I'll never forget this. I had problems with my computer. But all along, God had me printing all this stuff out. Daniel lost everything. I'm not kidding. Everything. I was so mad at him. But you know what? God is so faithful. He had me printing all this stuff out. So when Daniel gets upset, why are you printing all this out? I said, because I see something you don't see. That's coming. Let's just leave it at that. That way, I tell him so we don't fight. You know, God sees, God knows. All right, that's what we've got to learn to get along, saints. You know. I don't know why I'm going to tell you this. You know, we're coming up to my mother's. You know, she died May 10th, Mother's Day. You know, so you know, I thought of that because but I thought of that because of something. What did I just read you? Well, the date. Well, I'm looking at the date. It's May 3rd, and I was going to get a Mother's Day card for Daniel's mom. I was thinking about my mom, you know, because she passed away. She was only 39 years old. I was thinking how old she is. She's, she will be 72 this year. I was like, wow. I don't know why I'm sharing that. But maybe some of you know, you're going through that. You know, maybe you lost your mom, and you're hurting over that still, you know. There's nothing like a mother. You know, I miss my mother. I love my mom. And that, but you know, Jesus Christ, he's become everything to me. He's my mother. He's my father. He's everything. You know, and he'll be everything to you. Maybe you're going through that right now. And you feel so alone. And you feel like, God, where are you? You know, or you don't even know God. You know, and you feel like you're in your cave. You're alone. I want you to know you're not alone. That God loves you, you know, just like that song we sang, you are loved. And people need to know they're loved because the world is hurting right now. And we need to let them know that God loves them. There's a God out there that's real and he's alive and that he loves them. And maybe you're listening to me and you don't know Christ. Today is your day. You know, God will be there. He will help you through whatever you're going through. If you don't know Christ today, I want to pray with you. Just bow your head wherever you're at and let's pray. You know, or maybe you lost your mom and you need God to be near you. I want you to know he loves you. Let's just pray. Father, we just come together in agreement. If you don't know Christ, just ask Jesus. Say, Jesus, I believe you died for me to give me eternal life. Come into my heart and save me. I need you, Lord. Or maybe you don't, maybe you lost your mom and you're hurting. Just say, God, I need you to just be near me right now. I need you to help me through this time that I'm going through right now, Lord. Or maybe you lost your husband or wife, or you're going through some situation, you don't understand it. Just go to God, cry out to God. He hears you. We don't have to pray eloquently. You know, every time I get on there, I get nervous because I'm like, God, I don't even know what to say. But God helps me. I just yield myself to the Lord. And that's all we can do. God accepts us just the way we are. Isn't that awesome? God loves all of us just the way we are. So just go to God wherever you're at. Just begin to cry out to God and say, God, I need you. I need you, God. I can't do this, Lord. I see the way the world is changing, Lord. And I need you in my life. Make yourself known to me today. Draw me closer to you, I pray, in Jesus' name. Just pray that wherever you're at. He loves you. You know, there are times I get on here and I'm like, Lord, I'll start talking and I don't even know where I'm going. You know, and I have to trust that God's going to speak through me because You know, it's not easy doing this. Saints, I want you to know it's not easy. But remember, God says, you open your mouth and I will fill it. And it's so true. God will give you and I the words if we will just yield ourselves to God. You know, it doesn't matter who you are, how old you are, and maybe you feel like God can't use you. Oh, yes, he can. God takes the weak things of the world to confound the wise. And, you know, yes, he used a donkey. Maybe there are ladies that think you can't be used. Yes, God will use you, you know, or men. God will use you. All he's looking is at our hearts. He don't look at our outward appearance. Thank God. Aren't you glad? I'm glad because, you know, I'm a mess. I'm still a mess. And I'm like, God, I don't see how you're going to use me. But you're so worthy, Lord. I love you, God. You're so awesome. Isn't God awesome? I don't know how he puts up with me. I don't know how to. I said, God, how do you put up with me? I am a mess, God. You know, hey, you don't know everything. I do. You don't see it. I don't talk about it, but I have sins just like you. We're all changing from glory to glory. Let's quit judging one another. Let's quit judging our brothers or sisters, pointing our finger at them. You know, we all got things. God's working in all of us, all right? We're all a mess. The only one that's not a mess is Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us. He is so good. All right. I just felt like saying that. Praise God. All right, I'm going to share these words with you. This first word, children, you will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way. At 6:48, I heard him, because I told you, I was asking him when we're getting out of here, and he said, you will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way. And this is what he said, saints. Go in that direction, I hear the Lord saying. I will never lead you, my children, in what is astray if you learn to follow me. When you, my children, step out on your own, you will fall, says the Lord. Learn to sit patiently in my presence. That means do not move. Be still and wait upon me, says the Lord. I, the Lord, will open the door for you, my children, and make a clear way. There will be no hesitation or doubt, says the Lord. You will know exactly what I, the Lord, am telling you to do. Children, you will know that you know that you know this is me, the Lord, moving in your life. Again, children, I say, wait upon me. I, the Lord, will lead you and guide you in my ways, not the world's ways. Anytime you are in a rush and you have to move right this minute, that is not me, the Lord, moving in your life. That is your own flesh. And that's what I heard God say. So whenever you're being rushed and you feel like you got to do it right now, I'm going to tell you right now, no, it's not God. It's your own flesh because your flesh does not want to wait. I'm going to tell you that. I don't want to wait. I don't want to do this. But we've had to do it for over 25 years. We've had to wait. God did it. Not me. God did it. I, Lord, am a God of timing, he said, and I am in no hurry. My children do not want to wait upon me and sit at my feet. They expect me, the Lord, to move on their own timetable. Wait again, I say unto you. There is power in your waiting. As your flesh is dying, my power in you, my children, is getting stronger and stronger. It is no longer you striving to get your own way. You are dead, my children, to your own ways and alive to my spirit. Ride on the wings of my spirit. Let me, the Lord, take you up higher in my presence and anointing. Fly, fly, fly away in me, the Lord, like a beautiful dove or an eagle that soars to higher heights. Rest in me, says the Lord. Come away now, my children, and seek me, your heavenly Father. I, the Lord, am in the midst of all your tribulation and heartaches. Seek me now, says the Lord. You will find me, the Lord, in the secret place when you come away and sit at my feet, dear children. Come now, says the Lord. Stop putting it off for a later date. The time is now already late, my children. There is not much more time until the shaking. I'm about to shake all of heaven and earth. There is a new earth that is coming about. It will no longer look the same. The old way of doing things will be changed overnight. Remember, my children, I'm the same God as I was back then. The only difference is now, you, my children, will be looking to me to meet your daily needs. You will no longer depend on self. Self will no longer work. You must seek me, the Lord, to provide for you. I took care of the birds of the air. I, the Lord, will take care of you. Trust me, says the Lord. Do not worry about tomorrow. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Take each day as it comes. Now, this is me. I'm going to talk to you for just a moment. And I wrote it down with the Holy Spirit gave me. There are times in your Christian walk where you are walking blindly, like in a maze. You can barely hear God clearly. He is so quiet. That is a time to just wait. God is not telling you to move. Then there are times you may sense the Holy Spirit telling you to do this or that. He will usually confirm it to your spirit in more ways than one. Also, you may end up stepping out and finding out real quick that it is not God's will. And I've done that several times. You know, I'll step out and I know that's not God's will. And then I go back to where I left off. And that I'm going to tell you right now. Maybe I'm talking to some of you. You've stepped out. You thought that was God's will. And you found out it was not. All right. You need to go back to where you left off. Now, if there are some of you that can't go back, you need to go to God and you need to repent. And just say to him, God, I missed you. I made a mistake. Please put me back on track where I need to be. God knows your heart and he knows mine. We can't lie to the Lord, saints. He sees if your heart is right and you honestly made a wrong mistake, God will help you. But if you're willfully not listening or waiting and you just go ahead, you and I may end up in trouble. And that will happen if you are willfully disobeying the Lord. All right, if God has told you to do something and you're not listening and you're saying, God, I'm not going to do that, then yes, you'll end up in trouble. But if you honestly, truly made a mistake and you thought God was telling you to do this, God's not going to hit you over and beat you up. No. God is a loving Father and God will have mercy on you and he will forgive you. Just go to God and say, God, forgive me. Put me back on track where I need to be. And that means you go back on track. You go back to where you left off. But if you keep going away from God, it's going to get further and further you're going to go. All right? I'm talking to some people here. I don't know who. But the Holy Spirit is talking to you. You've walked away from the Lord. Now is your time to come back. Now is your time to bow your head and say, God, forgive me. I haven't been following you, Lord. I've been following my own way. But Lord, I need you now to help me. I can't do this on my own, Lord. I cannot follow you, Lord. I need you to help me, Lord. Put me back on track. I made mistakes. I did things on my own that I shouldn't have done. Forgive me, God. I need you to help me. And maybe you did do some things on purpose, but now you're seeing the light. And the Holy Spirit's talking to you. Maybe you still haven't given him your heart and life. Today's your day. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting until you're on your deathbed? It's too late. I'm going to tell you before you're going to go like that. There's going to be people that are going to go suddenly. Don't let that be said of you. Do you hear me? I'm talking to you. Stop being stubborn. There are those, I'm telling you right now, that are just being stubborn. They're not going to listen. They think it's over. It is not over. Do you hear what I'm saying? It is not over. It does not have to be over for you. And it doesn't matter where you live. Yes, there's going to be disasters everywhere. God will protect you and he'll take you home when it's his time, not your time or my time. I believe that our steps are ordered by the Lord. Okay, I'm going to tell you right now, Daniel, like mask thing. And we've talked about that before. Now, there are Christians that are wearing a mask. And I'm going to tell you right now, God told me to wear a mask. You better believe I wore a mask. I'm not wearing a mask. Daniel tells me if you go out, like, he told me if you go to a store or something, like to get your nails or something, wear a mask. I said, I'm not wearing a mask. Because I don't feel the Holy Spirit is telling me to put the mask on. And he was, you know, I guess if Daniel said so, I'll do it for Daniel. But I don't feel, he's worried about me because he goes, you've got asthma and I don't want anything to happen to you. Wear a mask. He's still with the doctor. I told you I had a problem with the mammogram because of my hormones. And he's still on with that. And I said, quit worrying about me. God's in control. God knows. You know, God knows what's going on. I know I'm okay. All right, now if God tells me to do something, better believe I'm going to do it. But he hasn't told me to do it. I told you I used to go to hospitals. I'd volunteer, and I'd literally walk in the room. Didn't do it on purpose. I'd forget to put the gown mask and goggles on. And I'd go in there to pray for them. And then when I walked out, I said, God, I forgot. But you know what? I'm all right. I'm still alive, right? But that was for me. God told me, you need to do what God is telling you to do. I'm not telling you don't wear a mask or don't go doing this. Don't go doing that. Move to another state. I know a lady told me about she moved to Arkansas. Others have moved there. No, I don't know. What God may tell you to do may not be the same thing he tells me to do. God will speak to us all differently. We've got to get in our prayer closets and we've got to seek God for us and our families and do whatever the Holy Spirit is telling us to do. We cannot listen to what everybody else is doing. And President Trump, hey, we've said this before, we can't go by a model. We can't go by the sports league. We can't go by, because what if those models are wrong? What if we're listening to these doctors and they're wrong? Let's go to God. Let's go to God in prayer and say, God, help us. We can't do this on our own. We see what's getting ready to happen and we need you to help us. But are we doing that? No. We're not going to God. We're not even praying. We're trying to handle it ourselves. Are we going to, I'm telling you, these other nations are getting weapons, preparing for war. Are we prepared? Are we going to go to battle without God? I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be a lot of bloodshed. We cannot do nothing with God. When are we going to learn that we've got to turn to God? When are we going to learn that? When is the church going to learn? You cannot do things on your own. You cannot be going here, going there, getting on the airplane, flying there, doing this. We don't live in the same period that it used to be. All right? Things have changed. Our world has changed. Our nation has changed. We've got to pray. We've got to know that we know that we know. God, you're telling me to. Now, I'm not saying live in fear and worry. I'm not saying that. But God will let us know if this is what he wants us to do or not. Don't just push ahead and just do it anyways. If God's telling you don't do it, you're going to bring trouble on yourself. That's what's going to happen. All right? So we got to go to God and just say, God, forgive me. Put me back where I need to be. And he'll help us. Okay? Let me just say this. Daniel and I got married early. Oh, Daniel, I don't know. We knew each other a few months. We didn't wait. I didn't even know about waiting. I just came to God. When Daniel married me, he thought he got married to a military sergeant. You know, he's had to put up with me, and now I've had to put up with him. We've had to put up with each other. That's right. God showed me. Daniel loves me unconditionally. God showed me that he needs me. Because I help him spiritually, but he loves me unconditionally. There's a reason. We don't understand. I guess opposites attract. I don't know where, but that's what God says. We're about to kill each other. No, I'm just kidding. God help us. Hey, don't act like you're not killing one another. You're living in a cave with family members. Don't tell me everything's going great for you. No, it's not. Don't lie. I know I'm not the only one. But Daniel, I've been in a cave for how many years? I'm surprised we haven't killed each other. No, seriously, it's God. I give God praise. He sits out in the living room. I'm in my bedroom. We're okay. He's out there and I'm in here. That way we don't crowd each other, get on each other's nerves. Hey, the church didn't get along. Remember the disciples? They couldn't get along. They went their separate ways. We got to learn to get along. God help us. Help me. Shut my mouth. You know, hey, I'm a preacher. I'm a talker. Yes, we ladies, we love to talk. If you haven't learned yet, we ladies love to talk. And, you know, we can't nag our husbands. We got to pray and love our husbands and be that submissive, loving wife. Lord, I'm not there yet. Please help me, God. Please help me. Daniel puts up with me. Daniel loves me unconditionally. And, you know, that's the way Daniel is. And he's amazing in that. He loves me unconditionally. Praise God. I don't know how I got into that. But, yeah, we got married early. Daniel and I got married. We only knew each other a few months. We've been married, what, how many years? I always forget. We got married in 92. I say 02, 12. We just celebrated in January. What is it? 92, 02, 12, 15, 16, 17. Yeah, 28 years. By the grace of God, it's 28 and a half years almost. It's God. I give God the praise. I give him the honor. I give him the glory. It's God all the way. I'm going to tell you right now. Only Daniel can put up with me. I'm going to tell you right now. Only Daniel can put up with me. So I give God praise for that. All right. But we, you know, we made a mistake. And, you know, hey, I'm going to tell you right now. Maybe you made a mistake. I'm just going to talk about that. You know, maybe you made a mistake and you feel like God can't use you. Oh, yes, he can. God can use your mistake for his good. God's amazing. Yeah, we've had a lot of trials. We've had a lot of trials. But God can work it out. He can use it for his good. He knows exactly what he's doing. You know, sometimes we don't listen. Hey, we're not dead. You're not dead. And hey, I may make more mistakes in the near future. None of us are dead yet, all right? That's why I said we can't keep judging one another. We learn from our mistakes. None of us are perfect. We're going to make mistakes. The only one that's perfect is Jesus. All right? All right. And I had talked about this earlier, but I'm not going to really touch on it. But like I was saying about making mistakes, you know, maybe you moved to another state, you took a new job, or you got a divorce. God can turn that around. I'm going to tell you right now. So don't think God can't use your mistake. Yes, he can. So he can use you right where you're at. He's going to use it for your good. All right, let me read you a few of these Bible scriptures here. Isaiah 4, 29 through 31, I love this. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They'll run and not grow weary. They'll walk and not be faint. Isaiah 55, 8, 9, I love this. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Jeremiah 29:11-13. I know the thoughts I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Verse 12, then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. Verse 13, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. I'm going to read this to you. It's Psalm 32, 8 through 10. It's from the Passion Translation. I hear the Lord saying, I will stay close to you, instructing and guiding you along the pathway for your life. See, God's going to look out for you. He will guide you and instruct you. And it goes on to say, I will advise you along the way and lead you forward with my eyes as your guide. So don't make it difficult. Don't be stubborn. I love the way it reads here. When I take you where you've not been before. Don't make me tug you and pull you along. Just come with me. Verse 10, so my conclusion is this. Many are the sorrows and frustrations of those who don't come clean with God. But when you trust in the Lord for forgiveness, his wraparound love will surround you. I love that. Psalm 32, 8 through 10. From the Passion Translation. I may read it again. I hear the Lord saying, I will stay close to you, instructing and guiding you along the pathway for your life. I will advise you along the way and lead you forth with my eyes as your guide. So don't make it difficult. Don't be stubborn when I take you where you've not been before. Don't make me tug you and pull you along. Just come with me. Verse 10, so my conclusion is this. Many are the sorrows and frustrations of those who don't come clean with God. But when you trust in the Lord for forgiveness, His wraparound love will surround you. See, so don't be stubborn. All right? God sees something you don't see. So you may not know where you're going, but walk blindly with Him and trust the Lord today. Whatever you're going through, it may be a difficult situation. You may not understand it. But you have to trust Him, saints. You hear me? You have to trust God. Who are you going to trust? You can't trust the world. You can't look to your president. You can't look to your mayor, governor. You got to look to God. All right? You can read this. I'm not going to read it. Luke 10, 38-42. Jesus visits Martha and Mary. I like this. John 12, 24-26. This talks about a grain of wheat falling to the ground and dying. I love this. John 12, 24-26 from the Passion. Verse 24, let me make this clear. A single grain of wheat will never be more than a single grain of wheat unless it drops into the ground and dies, because it sprouts and produces a great harvest of wheat. Because then it sprouts and produces a great harvest of wheat, all because one grain died. Verse 25, the person who loves his life and pampers himself will miss true life. But the one who detaches his life from this world and abandons himself to me will find true life and enjoy it forever. Verse 26, if you want to be my disciple, follow me and you will go where I'm going. And if you truly follow me as my disciple, the Father will shower his favor upon your life. See, if you want to be God's disciple, then you got to follow God wholeheartedly. You've got to die to the things of this world, saints. And that's not easy. It's painful. It hurts. I'm sure a lot of you are in your caves right now. There are things you're not able to go and do. You're dying. Your flesh is dying. That's what's happening right now. Okay, because you didn't want to do it yourself. God's doing it for you. Because He's coming back, saints, for a bride without spot or wrinkle. But we have to cooperate with God. We can't fight against the Lord. That's why I told you there are people out there starting riots and doing things on their own that God didn't tell them to do. We've got to pray. We've got to submit to God. We've got to submit to authority, whether we like it or not. Yes, it may not be right. But that's why we pray. God sees. All right, so God's got a plan. He's got a plan for you. He's got a plan for me. And as we get in line with God, God will fulfill His plan in your life and my life. But we can miss His plan, saints, if we don't cooperate with God. God showed me that not too long ago. And I tell Daniel that we've got to cooperate with God. Couples, yes, we've got to cooperate. If one's not willing to cooperate and the other one is, all we can do is pray and do what's right. That's all you and I can do. Leave the other one in God's hands and do what God's asking us to do. And sometimes it's hard. I know. Sometimes it's very hard. That's why He stays out there and I stay in here. Because, you know, if you can't get along, sometimes it's better to just, He's out there, I'm in here. You know, we're together by the grace of God. I give God the glory. I give God the glory. Now, I pray God help us. You know, I'm just going to be honest with you. You know, it's not just me. I know you're going through it too. It's not easy when you're married. Why is it married people want to be single? Single people want to be married. It's not easy. It's very, very hard. You've got to deny yourself, your wants, your desires. Not be selfish. God help me not be selfish. Yes, hey, I can be selfish. Daniel knows. Daniel's more giving in ways than I am. And Lord, help me not be selfish. And think of Him and think of others. And God said we're to think of others more highly than ourselves. And that goes for the church. You know, we need to be helping out those that are hurting in the church. and doing whatever God's asking us to. You know, that's what God's pleased with. Us walking in love, having the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience. That's not easy. I'm going to tell you right now, it's not easy. But God will do it in you and me as we die more and more to ourselves and to our world. And that's not easy. But we got to ask God, do it in us. Change us. Mold us. Make us more like you. Because I'm going to tell you right now, your own flesh doesn't want to do it. Your flesh will fight. Your flesh will fight against whatever God wants to do in you and me. But we have to submit and cooperate and say, God, have your way. And yes, you're going to cry. Yes, you will do a lot of crying. I've done tons of crying in my cave. You will cry. And maybe you're crying now. God's there. He's there and he will help you. He will help you get through whatever you got to go through. All right. Let me see if there's any more on this I want to talk about. Remember, Jesus called the 12 disciples. The other disciples walked away. Okay, are you going to walk away too or follow Jesus? Remember, I told you the great falling away is near. What are you going to do? I know my girlfriend tells me all the time, I couldn't do what you do. She's sitting there in her cave, you know, she's not saying nothing now. I love her to death. She ain't coming at me at all. No, her husband saw his job, thank God. But I know her and her husband probably get into it. You know, so she's in her cave. But, and, you know, she's used to going about, and she's a little Martha. I love her death. She, her and her husband help everyone. But, you know, she's at home right now. And so she said, if I had to do what you're doing, I couldn't do it. And we can't do it. Do you hear what I'm saying? You can't do it. You've got to lean on God. You think I could have done this all these years? No. I could have done it. God did it. God made Daniel where he couldn't get around. God made me handicapped where I couldn't go anywhere. God did it. We just yielded ourselves to God. Yes, I could have fought against it and said, God, I ain't doing it. I've said that many of them. I say, God, I'm done. I'm not doing another video, Lord. I'm finished. Hurry up, Lord. Hey, I'm being honest with you. Don't tell me you don't get upset. Oh, yes, you do. Don't tell me you don't get angry at God. Yes, you do. If you say you don't, then you're lying. God knows your heart. God's amazing. Sometimes I'm like, God, I've said things I've had to repent of. Yes, I've gotten mad at God. Yes, I'm not going to lie and say I haven't. Yes, I've gotten mad because I don't see what he's doing. His ways are not our ways, saints. We don't see everything God's doing. And it hurts. It hurts. Everything in you is going to die. But we have to trust God has a better plan than what we think. Yeah, I've done a lot of crying sitting in this cave. And I'll probably do more when I get out of this cave. But God had a plan. God had a reason. I don't understand everything. And maybe you don't understand everything. You're like, God, why? Why, God? Why are you doing this to me? Why? I've said that several times. Why, God? Why am I going through this? Why are you doing this, Lord? I love you, God. Why are you doing this? God knows. He knows what you're going through. He understands the hurt and the pain. He knows. Father, I pray those are hurting right now. They don't understand what they're going through, Lord. Father, you do, Lord. You see the pain in their heart, oh God. You see the suffering, Lord. And they're asking you, God, why? Why, God? Why are you doing this, Lord? Father, I ask that you would comfort them. I ask that you be near them, Lord. Father, be closer to them than our brothers. Stick near them, Lord, right now. I pray for them. Wrap your arms of love around them. May they feel unloved. May they feel like nobody cares about them, oh God. But show them that you love them, oh God. That you care about them. That they're not alone, Lord. Pray for them right now in Jesus' name. Comfort their hearts, Lord. They're hurting, I pray, right now in Jesus' name. God is there. God is there. When the world walks out on you, God is there. Do you hear me? When the world walks out on you, God Almighty is there. That's right. God is there. Maybe you're sitting in that cave, you're alone, and you're ready to get to give up. You're ready to call it quits. Don't give up, says the Lord. Don't give up. You hold on with everything that's inside of you. God is there, and God will help you. That is for somebody. I don't know who. God wants me to encourage you. Don't give up. You hold on. If God has placed a promise in your heart, you hold on to that promise. You don't give up. God sees and he knows. You've got to trust him. You've got to hold on to him with everything that's in you. I'm going to tell you right now, you can't hold on to nothing else. The world's passing away. The only thing you have to hold on to is Jesus. So you got to hold on to the Lord with everything that's inside of you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. You are so good. We don't understand. We don't understand what you're doing, Lord. None of us do. None of us do. But, Father, we trust you. We trust you, Lord. We don't trust man. We don't trust our president. We don't trust our governor. We don't trust no one, God. But we trust you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you for saving us, oh God. Where will we be without you? Where will we be, God, without you? Maybe I'm talking to some of you and you still haven't given your heart much. If I say it's the time, don't wait. Don't put it off for a later day. Call the name of the Lord. Everyone that calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. That's all you got to do. Wherever you're at, call on Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So we got to come out. We got to come out. We got to be separate. We can't touch no unclean thing. 2 Corinthians 6:17-18 says, therefore come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean and I will receive you. I'll be a father to you and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. And then 1 John 2:15-17, do not love the world. That's what's been happening. The church loves the world. We're trying to fit in with the world. Why are we trying to fit in with the world? We've got to come out. We've got to come out. Do you hear me? It's time the church come out. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. I didn't say that. Don't get mad at me. God said it. If you want to get mad at someone, you need to get mad at God. God said it. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Maybe I should read it again to get into some of you. Do not love the world or the things in the world. This is 1 John 2:15-17. Don't get mad at me. God said this. See, we don't read this. These scriptures that I'm reading, we don't read them. We don't want to hear it. Now you got to hear it. Now you're in your cave, you got to hear it. We didn't want to preach in that church because people wouldn't give. Now there's going to be no money. Look at the economy. It was down 600 points just on Friday. It's getting ready to go down even more. Now we're going to preach the truth. Now God's getting ready to have truth be told. That's right. God told me years ago when people would say, just give this and you'll get this. And I got upset because we give and give and give and nothing happened. And God said to me, just keep your eyes on me. And as God began to work in me, he was showing me that when you put him first and you love him above everything else will come in line. Then you're going to use the money he gives you for the right purposes, not for your own selfish gain. It's for God's purposes. Do you hear me? If he can't trust us with earthly riches, how are you going to trust us with heavenly riches? Hey, I'm talking to some of you pastors. You've had your money, and you didn't do right with that money. It's time you repent. It's time you get on your knees and go to God and say, God, forgive me. I didn't do right with the money that you gave my church. I pocketed your money. That wasn't my money, but I pocketed it. I went on vacations with it. I did what I wanted to do. I didn't help nobody in the church. Meanwhile, the old lady come to church. She can't pay a rent or put food on the table. And you're sitting there spending all the money buying these big cars or spending all that money on these vacations. You're using the church's money. That ain't your money. Hey, I know I'm convicting some people. You're spending God's money. That is not your money to spend. God gives us all money, all right? I'm not going to say God don't bless you. Yes, God's going to bless me. I already know that. But I'm going to tell you right now, his money's going to be used for his purposes. It's not my money to do what I want to do with it. Because I'm going to stand before the Lord one day, and he's going to ask me, what'd you do? And if I didn't do what I was supposed to, he's going to say, away from me, I never knew you. It's important that we do right with what God gives us right here and now. Because he's not going to give us bigger riches up in heaven. If we can't do what God is asking us to do right here and now, we're not going to obey him later. If we won't, like I've said before, we won't obey authority now, right here. I mean, how are we going to listen to God? There are people that won't even listen to their authority. If you're not listening to your governors, mayors, or president, how are you going to listen to God? You're not going to listen to God. You won't even obey man. All right, let me finish reading this. 1 John 2:15-17. Let me start again. Do not love the world. Do not love the world or things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Verse 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, it's not the Father, but is of the world. Verse 17, and the world is passing away. I think that's what we're saying. It's passing away. It's going quickly. And the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. So you got to be doing God's will. You notice how it says here? But he who does the will of God abides forever. Whose will are you doing? Are you doing God's will or your own will? Hey, I'm talking to some of you Christians. Whose will are you doing? Are you doing God's will or your own will? Playing your own life, going here, going there, doing this, doing that. I'm talking to some of you. God loves you. He loves you and I enough to warn us. Okay? But if we don't listen, I mean, I don't know. I don't know all that God's going to do. Could we be left here? I don't know. I don't want to be here. I'm going to tell you right now. I don't want to be here. I want to make sure I'm going home when Jesus comes and gets me, whatever that is. I want to make sure I'm out of here. I don't want to be like Lot's wife, turn back, want to stay. Because I'm going to tell you right now, there ain't nothing here to stay for. This world is passing away quickly. There is nothing here in this world. I'm going to tell you right now. There is not one thing. As you grow with the Lord, you're going to become more dead. You're going to realize that more. There is nothing here. There is nothing. Yeah, there may be some enjoyment for a little while, but then it goes away. The only thing that, it's like we got to keep going to God. It's like he fills us up as a gas tank, right? There's nothing that'll fill you. It'll leave you empty. Only Jesus will fill you. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Let me see if that's it here. All right. That's it on that word. All right. Let me put that up here. Let's play. I'm going to play some music, I think, before I start this other word. Play a few more music. Then I'll read this word. We're going to play some Getting in the Presence of God. Sanctuary. I love this song.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living
Jesus. read this to you real quick. The Holy Spirit gave this to me.
It's in Romans 8. We want to yield our hearts to the Lord. This is more than conquerors. I want to read this to you. 8, starting verse 28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those He predestined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. Those He justified, He also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also, along with Him, graciously give us all things? Verse 33, who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Verse 34. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who is raised to life, is at the right hand of God, is also interceding for us. Verse 35. I love this. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors. Amen. Through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's right. Nothing will separate you and I from the Lord. Praise God. I want one more song here to play.
I want to hear the power of your word. Feel the weight of glory fall. I wanna know the one who overcomes. I wanna see, I wanna be undone. Come, Holy Spirit, come, rushing like a flood.
Nothing else, nothing else.
what only you can do. Cause we are desperate for your presence. God, we have to have your presence. You're everything we want. You're everything we need, Lord. And we're desperate for your presence. Holy Spirit, oh, we have to have your presence. So would you move in our heart? Would you move in our hearts? Let me walk on you tonight.
Praise the Lord. All right, I'm going to read this last word to you. I may put this music on really low. I want to make sure, though, you can hear me. Never know, because I'm afraid if I play it. It may be loud on your end. This one, I heard the Holy Spirit say this to me at 11:48 a.m. out of nowhere. I heard him say, my timing is not like your timing, says the Lord. I called it, children, my timing is not like yours. In just a little while, I will come and get you out of this evil world, says the Lord. Then I heard the Lord say to destroy themselves. Your world is evil and wicked. I'm coming, says the Lord, to divide nations. There are those that sit behind closed doors up in the nations, and I, the Lord, will root out. I heard that from the Lord. These men and women are causing evil to work against my plan. My plan, says the Lord, shall prevail against theirs, says the Lord. Man thinks he's in charge. I tell you, I, the Lord, am in control of man, what he says and does. Man will no longer have his way down here, says the Lord. I, the Lord, will have my way. Man will now have to submit to me, I heard him say. The end is almost here for America. Now, I'm not talking about the end of America completely. This is the end of what we've known it to be. There is a change that is coming. It's time for you, my children, to seek me, for the hour is very late. I, the Lord, am coming back with a rod in my mouth to judge the world of its wickedness. Children, you are my strong ones, I heard the Lord say. You are not weak, you are strong in me. Lean upon me, the Lord, for your strength. Do not try to carry the load yourselves. It is too much for you. Cast your burdens, your cares upon me. Do not take on more than what I, the Lord, have called you to do. Do not be Martha, says the Lord. Be Mary. Sit at my feet. Spend time with me, says the Lord. Get to know me like your best friend or spouse, I heard him say. In order to know them, you must spend time with them. In order to know me, the Lord, and my ways, you must spend time in my presence. Then I heard God say that word, alone. Sit quietly, saying nothing and doing nothing. My Holy Spirit will show up, and children, you will feel my presence. My presence will be stronger now than it has ever been before. Some of you will feel my presence like fire. I'll begin to burn away everything in you that displeases me. Some I will cleanse and you will begin to cry nonstop. Others will feel me like a cool, refreshing breeze above my spirit like it was during the book of Acts. You'll feel a breeze like I just entered a doorway or window. This is my Holy Spirit manifesting on you, says the Lord. Others will have the joy of the Lord return to them. They have been downcast for so long. I want to return their joy to them, I heard the Lord say. Then I heard the Lord say, there will be those I will begin healing after they have repented of their sins or backsliding. This will not happen for everyone. If you do not get healed yet, do not stop believing the Lord is telling me to tell you. Keep believing for your miracle. Hold on until your very last breath. Do not be afraid, God is telling me to tell you. You've been crying out to the Lord for his presence and touch. God is going to show up in many of your lives through the Holy Spirit. Jesus left here with us. This is going to begin happening in your lives quickly, I heard him say. Look for me, says the Lord. Your life is going to begin to change now, I heard the Lord say. I thought it was done, and then I heard him say something else. Then I heard the Lord say, the Holy Spirit is also going to start waking many of you up with dreams, words, and visions like it was in the book of Acts, his true prophetic servants. Get ready, it is coming. Meaning of the word root out, to destroy all traces of, to draw out by force or with effort. Remove, take out, clean up. So God is going to root out everything that's not of him. Acts 2, this is the Passion Translation. The Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. On the day Pentecost was being fulfilled, all the disciples were gathered in one place. Suddenly they heard the sound of a violent blast of wind rushing into the house from out of the heavenly room. The roar of the wind was so overpowering was all anyone could bear. Then all at once, a pillar of fire appeared before their eyes. It separated into tongues of fire that engulfed each one of them. Verse 4, they were all filled and equipped with the Holy Spirit and were inspired to speak in tongues, empowered by the Spirit to speak in languages they have never learned. Now at the time, there were Jewish worshipers who had emigrated from many different lands to live in Jerusalem. When the people of the city heard the roaring sound, crowds came running to where it was coming from, stunned over what was happening because each one could hear the disciples speaking in his own language. Bewildered, they said to one another, aren't these all Galileans? So how is it that we hear them speaking in our own languages? Verse 9, we are northeastern Iranians, northwestern Iranians, Elamites, and those from Mesopotamia, Judea, East Central Turkey, the coastal areas of the Black Sea, Asia, North Central Turkey, Southern Turkey, Egypt, Libyans, who are neighbors of Cyrene, visitors from all over the Roman Empire. Both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. Yet we hear them speaking of God's mighty wonders in our own dialects. Verse 12. They all stood there dumbfounded and astonished, saying to one another, "What is this phenomenon?" Verse 13. But others poked fun at them and said, "They're just drunk on new wine." Verse 14. Peter stood up with the 11 apostles and shouted to the crowd, "Listen carefully, my fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem. You need to clearly understand what's happening here. These people are not drunk like you think they are, for it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. This is the fulfillment of what was prophesied through the prophet Joel. For God said, verse 17, this is what I will do in the last days. I will pour out my spirit on everybody and cause your sons and daughters to prophesy, and your young men will see visions, and your old men will experience dreams from God. Verse 18, the Holy Spirit will come upon all my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. I will reveal startling signs and wonders in the sky above and mighty miracles on the earth below. Blood and fire and pillars of clouds will appear. For the sun will return to dark and the moon blood red before the great and awesome appearance of the day of the Lord. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Verse 22, Peter continued, "People of Israel, listen to the facts. Jesus the Victorious was a man on a divine mission whose authority was clearly proven. For you know how God performed many powerful miracles, signs, and wonders through him." Verse 23, "This man's destiny was prearranged, for God knew that Jesus would be handed over to you to be crucified and that you would execute him on a cross by the hands of lawless men. Yet it was all part of his predetermined plan. God destroyed the cords of death and raised him up because it was impossible for death's power to hold him prisoner." Verse 25, "This is the very thing David prophesied about him. I continue to see the Lord in front of me. He is at my right hand and I'm never shaken. No wonder my heart is glad and my glory celebrates. My mouth is filled with his praises and I have hope that my body will live." Verse 27, "Because you will not leave my soul among the dead, nor will you allow your sacred one to experience decay. For you have revealed to me the pathways to life, and seeing your face fills me with euphoria. I can't pronounce. Verse 29, "My fellow Jews, I can tell you there is no doubt that our noted patriarch has both died and been buried in his tomb, which remains to this day. So you can see that he was not referring to himself with those words." Verse 30, "But as a prophet, he knew God's faithful promise made with God's unbreakable oath that one of his descendants would take his throne." Verse 31, "So when peering into the future, David prophesied of the Messiah resurrection, and God revealed him that the Messiah would not be abandoned to the realm of death, nor would his body experience decay." Verse 32, "Can't you see it? God has resurrected Jesus, and we all have seen him." Verse 33, "Then God exalted him to his right hand upon the throne of the highest honor, and the Father gave him the authority to send the promised Holy Spirit, which is being poured out upon us today. This is what you're seeing and hearing." Verse 34, "David wasn't the one who ascended into heaven, but the one who prophesied. The Lord Jehovah said to my Lord, I honor you by enthroning you beside me till I make your enemies a footstool beneath your feet." Now everyone in Israel can know for certain that Jesus whom you crucified is the one God has made both Lord and the Messiah. The crowds respond to Peter's words. When they heard this, they were crushed and realized what they had done to Jesus. Deeply moved, they said to Peter and the other apostles, "What do we need to do, brothers?" Peter replied, "Repent and return to God. And each one of you must be baptized in the name of Jesus, the anointed one, to have your sins removed. Then you may take hold of the gift of the Holy Spirit." Verse 39, "For God's promise of the Holy Spirit is for you and your families, for those yet to be born, and for everyone whom the Lord calls to himself."
Verse 4, Peter preached to them and warned them with these words, be rescued from the wayward and perverse culture of this world. Those who believe the word that day numbered 3,000. They were all baptized and added to the church. Verse 4:2, every believer was faithfully devoted to following the teachings of the apostles. Their hearts were mutually linked to one another, sharing communion and coming together regularly for prayer. A deep sense of holy awe swept over everyone, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders, and we're getting ready to see that. All the believers were in fellowship as one body, and they shared with one another whatever they had. Verse 4:5, out of the generosity, they even sold their assets to distribute the proceeds to those who were in need among them. Daily, they met together in the temple courts and one another's homes to celebrate communion. And I believe this is going to start happening with homes. People are going to be praying together, even in churches. I believe we're getting ready to see this. They shared meals together with joyful hearts and tender humility. They were continually filled with praises of God, enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord kept adding to their number daily those who were coming to life. All right, one more scripture, Revelation 19:11-16. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he was riding it. It's called Faithful and True. Trustworthy, this is the Amplified, loyal, incorruptible, steady, and in righteousness he judges and wages war on the rebellious nations. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many royal crowns. And he has a name inscribed on him, which no one knows or understands except himself. Verse 13, he is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, dressed in fine linen, dazzling white and clean, followed him on white horses. God's preparing an army, praise God. Verse 15, from his mouth comes a sharp sword, his word, which he may strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, and he will tread the winepress of the fierce wrath of God, the Almighty, in judgment of this rebellious world, and on his robe and on his thigh, his name is inscribed, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. Jesus is coming back. I don't know when, but he's coming back for a bride without spot or wrinkle. And he's going to make you and I that bride, that army he's coming back for. I believe, like I've said before, there's going to be one last mighty move of God before the Lord returns. I want to read this to you. This was a word from Prophecy News. It shall be just like it was at Pentecost. I will gather my chosen vessels, equip, train, and fully transform them with the power of my Holy Spirit. Just as it was with the apostles at Pentecost, we just read, so it shall be with my chosen vessels. I shall gather them together as in one accord in my holy mountain, a place I chose before eternity for this purpose. They will be trained and equipped for my work. At the end of the days, which shall not be many, they shall be fully be baptized by my Holy Spirit, just as it were the apostles in the first church. And I believe there's going to be more. God is calling all of us to follow him. The harvest is plenty, but the workers are few. He needs you. Do you hear me? He needs you now to stand up and do what's right in this nation and this world. Not all my children were gathered at the upper room, but only the apostles and the others that were chosen with them. Yet I had so many who believed and walked with me. So sure will be my children. I am of old. I change not, and there is nothing new under the sun. Just as the early first revival had begun at Pentecost, so the last end time revival begun in great power and glory. At the climax of this gathering, many souls shall be harvested out of my kingdom, just like it was in the first revival. And I believe that. As the early church rose in glory, shall the last end time church rise in greater glory. At the end of Pentecost, the apostles were scattered and they brought revival in various areas. My spirit moved to witness in great power and glory. So shall the transformed be scattered all over the world, bringing revival and a great awakening in all the places I shall take them.
Just as I acted with the early church at the Pentecost, so shall I do and act with the elect, my chosen vessel. And I believe that. He says, just as persecution increased after I erupted and manifested my church in great power and glory during the apostles, so it shall be with you, my chosen vessels. As my church is rising up in great power and glory, so shall the level of persecution increase and spread quickly all over against my true church. Fear not, just as I was with the early apostles, so I shall be with you, for I will lead and guide you in every step. And I believe that, saints. God will lead you and me and guide us if we are walking with the Lord, saints. We're going to be persecuted. If you're going to be used by God in these last days, you and I are going to suffer persecution. I want to read you this poem and we're going to pray. Jesus Christ is your safe haven. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Life is full of storms. With Jesus as our cornerstone, we will not cower. It is time for us Christians to stand up tall. Jesus Christ is our safe haven. We shall not fall. Maybe you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Why not give Him a call? Maybe that's you. I'm talking to you. You still have not called on Him. Say this. Just repeat this. Say, dear Jesus, I need you. Tell Him. Tell Jesus, I need you. I'm sinking. The waters are too deep. Catch me today. I give my heart and life to you. Humbly I pray. Jesus Christ is there when the winds blow. He will come to your rescue. Remember, Jesus moves real slow. Be not discouraged if He doesn't answer this day. Jesus is there. He did not walk away. Children, be patient and wait. Jesus is faithful. You, my child, will not faint. That's right. You will not faint. Mark 4, 35 through 41. This is the storm. It's from the Contemporary English Version. That evening, Jesus said to His disciples, let's cross to the east side. So they left the crowd, and the disciples started across the lake with Him in the boat. Some other boats followed along. Suddenly, a windstorm struck the lake. Waves started splashing into the boat, and it was about to sink. Verse 38, Jesus was in the back of the boat with His head on a pillow, and He was asleep. His disciples woke Him and said, teacher, don't you care that we're about to drown? Maybe you're saying, God, where are you? Don't you know we're about to drown? Don't you know what's getting ready to happen? Verse 39, Jesus got up and ordered the wind and the waves to be quiet. The wind stopped and everything was calm. Verse 40, Jesus asked His disciples, why were you afraid? Don't you have any faith? Verse 41, now they are more afraid than ever and said to each other, who is this? Even the winds and the waves obey Him. Maybe you're telling God, Lord, don't you see what's going on? Let me tell you, God sees. God knows. He wants you to trust Him. He's sitting in the back of the boat. He knows. He's not afraid. Why are you afraid? God's in control. It's all in the Bible. All you got to do is read the New Testament. Are you reading your Bible? We know what's going to happen, saints. We know. God warned us. If we're reading the Bible, this is not going to be a surprise. If we're not walking with God, we're not reading the Bible, we're not doing what He says, yes, we're going to go through things and we're not going to know what's going on. We're going to be lost. We don't need to be afraid. We don't need to worry. God took care of the birds of the air. He's going to take care of you and He's going to take care of me. We have to trust Him, saints. It's not easy. It's not easy. It's not easy for me to come up here and speak, but I got to do it. I got to do what God's called me to do. And you got to do it. Do you hear me? You can't be afraid. You can't be worried. You got to stand up and you got to speak the truth. God will protect you. God will provide for you. God knows what you're going through. So let's pray. Father, we come together as a body of believers, Lord. We're two or more. Great Father, you're in our midst, Lord. You see everything that's going on in America and in our world. Our world is changing, Lord. It's changing very quickly. We're losing our freedom here in America, Lord. But Lord, we know you're in control. We know that you direct man. Man does not direct himself. You are in charge, Father. You are in control. Man cannot do anything without you. You are the one that directs them, Lord. You're going to protect your children. You're going to provide for your children. And you, Lord, will get your children out of here at your appointed time. So we refuse to worry, Lord. We refuse to be afraid, Lord. We stand up tall in the power of the Holy Ghost, and we're going to go forth, and we're going to speak truth, and we're going to do your will, Lord. We don't serve man. We serve you, King Jesus. We don't care what man says. We don't care what the Democrats say. We don't care what the New World says. We don't care what the world's doing. Our eyes are fixed on you, Lord Jesus, and we're going to obey you, God. You are our master. You are our king. We humbly submit ourselves to you, Lord. So we stand up and we speak your word boldly in the name of Jesus. So, Father, we pray for those right now who are getting ready to send forth, Lord God, that they're going to speak in holy boldness of God, and that the power of the Holy Ghost is going to come upon them right now in Jesus' mighty name, that they're going to feel the fire of God, the fire of God in Jesus' name. They're going to feel the power of the Holy Ghost, Lord. It's not them doing it, Lord. It's you in them, oh God. It's in you speaking through them, Lord. They're just your vessel, Lord. They're just your vessel led by your Holy Spirit, Lord God. So I ask you to have your way, oh God. Have your way in our nation and in our world. Have your way in President Donald Trump, in Vice President Mike Pence, in the prayer team, in this world. Have your way. Have your way with the New World Order, with the Democrats, those that are sitting up in the White House and thinking they're going to have their way. Oh God, they're not going to have their way. You, God, will have your way. You, God, will do exactly what you said you're going to do. Because God, you are God, and we serve you, Jesus. We lift your name upon her. We worship you, oh God. We love you, God. We know that you're all powerful, Lord. You can do anything, oh God. There's nothing too hard for you, Lord. You can do greater miracles, Lord, that's ever been done. Because you said we shall do them if we but believe. And we children believe that now is the time. Now is the hour. For greater miracles shall go forth in the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for what you're about to do. Lord, we thank you. Start thinking of saints. Start thinking for what God is going to do. Every knee is going to bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's right. I said, Jesus Christ is Lord. Every knee is going to bow. Every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. The whole world will know that Jesus Christ is Lord. One day, Lord, one day, you're going to step out and every eye is going to see you, God. Every eye is going to see you. They may not believe right now, but they'll believe later because they're going to see you, God. They're going to see you. Hallelujah. I can feel the fire of the Holy Ghost. You are getting ready to rain down your spirit, oh God, rain down. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for what you're about to do. Praise you, God. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Just begin to praise Him. Just begin to thank Him. God's about to move. God's about to move in our nation, in our world. Miracles are getting ready to come forth. Miracles. Families are going to be saved. Those loved ones, those people you're praying for, friends, acquaintances, people in this nation, reporters are going to be saved. Journalists, those people that give you problems, your enemies. That's right, I said your enemies. Your enemies are going to get saved as you love them and as you pray for them. You are touching them. The Holy Ghost is going to touch them. He's going to save them. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you're about to save our enemies, Lord. Those that have done wrong against us. Thank you, Lord, for what you're about to do. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now I pray for a hedge of protection over all of us, Lord. A hedge of protection, Lord, over our present. Watch over him. Protect him, Lord. Protect him. Protect our nation. Protect our economy, oh God. Protect us from Russia, China, Iran, North Korea. Protect Israel, your chosen people, oh God. We lift up the nation of Israel, oh God. We pray for a hedge of protection over the nation of Israel, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for what you're about to do. Thank you, oh God. We praise you, Lord. Give him praise. Say, give him praise. Worship the Lord. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God that we serve. He's getting ready to do some awesome miracles. Awesome miracles. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you in advance. We praise you in advance for open doors. Open doors. You're getting ready to open doors for your people and for me. You're getting ready to open doors. We're getting ready to go out to the lion's den. And there are others. You're getting ready to send out into the lion's den. And there's going to be more, Lord. There's going to be more. There's going to be a revival, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for a mighty revival that's going to start in America and in our world, Lord. We thank you, Lord. I don't know how long it's going to be, but it's going to be a revival. Lord, I pray. Oh, pray that we do what we're called to do as we wait upon you, Lord. As we wait and as we seek you, Lord, that you'll lead us and guide all of us. Give us wisdom. Give us direction, Lord, to be led by your Spirit, Lord. Not move on our own, Lord, but that we hear your voice. Oh, God, that we hear your voice clearly, Lord. We turn to the right and we turn to the left, Lord. We keep our eyes fixed on you because there's going to be many distractions, Lord. Things that are going to try to pull our attention away from you, Lord. So I ask you to please help all of us. Help us, Lord. Lord, to keep walking with you daily, Lord, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, saints, I wanted to bring that word to you today. I felt the Holy Spirit wanted me to bring it now, so I just did it. You know, all glory goes to God. I'm telling you, miracles are about to start. I know, and I know others knew, because I can, when I read some of their words, after God spoke to me, I, you know, it's like we're all in this together. It's a confirmation. So I know God is getting ready to call his chosen. You know, we don't need to be jealous. Remember I talked about that? We all got different gifts. We come together. We work together. All right? He's going to send more of us out. But we've got to obey the Lord, saints. Okay? We cannot expect God to use us if we're not obeying the Lord. We've got to obey the Lord and do whatever it is he's asking us to do. And if he's giving you a gift, you need to use that gift as unto the Lord. All right, I think that's it. I don't know how long we've been on here, but you know what? It doesn't matter. I want to be led by the Holy Ghost. It's all about Jesus. All right, before we go, the Holy Spirit just reminded me, if you'd like to help us in this ministry, there have been those that have given gifts, and God bless you for your giving. We're not about money because we don't have a lot of money. But you know what? Thank you. Thank you. God bless you for those that have stuck with us all this time. God bless you. We have people that partner, couple partners, God bless you. You know who you are. We've got people that give financial gifts here and there. Thank you. God bless you. I may not be able to write every single one of you. I may not be able to talk to each one of you, pray for y'all. But I want you to know we love you. We're praying for you. And hopefully in time, we'll have people that will help us. If you'd like to give a gift to Dawn's Heartfelt Corner, you can send it in the mail. Dawn's Heartfelt Corner, P.O. Box 161273, Altamont Springs, Florida 32716. You can partner online at www.dawnsheartfeltcorner.org. You'll see my old hair. It was blonde at that time. That's how old it is. You can give a gift right now through PayPal, heartfeltcorner10@gmail.com. If we're your church or we're speaking into your life, please help us in this ministry. And you know what? I'm going to put all that on there. And that's all I'm going to say, because you know what? It's not about money. Because eventually money's going to go out the door. All right? So I want you to know we appreciate you. And thank you. Now, if you've got a special prayer need you want me to see, put it to my attention. If you're mailing it, put Prophetess Dawn O'Brien, or if you've got a gift, put it to my attention, Prophetess Dawn O'Brien, because if not, I won't see it, because I know the mail will eventually come in. It's gonna come in. And I haven't been nothing in there, I mean, yet, but it's coming. I know it is. And you know, so if you've got some, the rest of the mail, just put it in the mail. You know, don't send me everything. I'm going to be very busy. But I want you to know I'm praying for you. And we're just waiting. We're sitting here waiting. And we're expecting, you expect, because God has great things for you too. All right? I want you to know that. God does. And whether or not your vision comes to pass today, tomorrow, next day, don't give up. Do you hear me? Don't give up. You've got to hold on to it. There's going to be others that will discourage you and say it's not going to happen. But you've got to have faith and believe. You know, God didn't give that vision to them. He gave it to you. So you hold on to that vision. You don't give up to it. All right. All right. I want you to know we love you. We're praying for you. And hopefully we'll be out of this cave soon. All right. Until we meet again, this is Prophetess Dawn O'Brien, Servant of the Lord with Dawn's Heartfelt Corner. Talk to you soon. God bless.